Carter is a brand of carpenter.
Hi, how are you? Good.
Excuse me. Synthetic, synthetic flooring. It's not really carpet. It's non-allergenic synthetic flooring.
I thought people would see them. You can think of a better place to put them.
Is Dwight not getting along with the rest of the administration?
No. We're taking care of him.
Us, besides, the school hasn't even started.
The teams at work.
No, you've got the page.
Never mind.
The school meeting, school board meeting of Tuesday, August 26, 1997 is called to order. We're on hold waiting for the flag, Pledge of Allegiance.
Has it been unfurled yet, Seth?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
The first order of business is adjustment to the agenda. Under new business, item H, consideration of a request of the acceptance of a foreign student to the high school. I'm moving to the first A position. It will be the first under new business. We will add a transfer of funds to new business. Consideration of a resignation of a board member to new business. And the business manager nomination. Any other adjustments? Seeing none, we move on to approval of school board meeting minutes on June 10th, 1997, regular meeting, a June 9th, 1997, special meeting, and a August 11th, 1997, special meeting.
On June 9th, I was left off of the Finance Committee under 3.
Okay, I have also, with the resignation of a board member, have asked Beth to switch from Finance to Policy. So the Finance Committee will be Keith Witherall Chair, John Ridge, and I appoint myself to even it out. Under Policy, George Entwistle, Chair, Kevin Sweeney, and Beth Currier. With the departure of a board member for negotiations, teacher negotiations, Anne will be replaced by myself. Any other adjustments?
On June 9th, special special meeting on the paragraph 8. Show that the motion was carried unanimously 7-0.
Any other changes? The minutes stand?
Just a clarification on June 9th, the meeting. I called Mary early today about a change in that, so there are fresh. Okay.
Also a question for Charlie. The teacher negotiations, there was only one person appointed?
No. Actually, it was George Entwistle, John Ridge, and now Charles Ridge.
Okay. And so that replaces that standing committee that we have listed here?
Right. It's specifically teacher negotiations at this point.
Yeah.
That's the way it's
teacher negotiations.
The only ones we appointed were teacher negotiations.
Okay, I see.
Any others? The minutes now stand as corrected. Our next agenda is comments by high school, middle school reps. School is not in session, so we don't know.
They'll be with us next time.
Communications?
I have none. We do have a resignation from the school board, and we did receive communication from Deborah Lane, the town clerk, that we will fill that position at the election, the referendum election on November 4th. And if people are interested in filling that vacancy, it's for the remainder of this year until the May election. They can pick up papers at the town hall, and if you give me a second, I can tell you when the deadline is.
I believe it's September 22nd.
That sounds right to me, but, oh, I have it right here. Wait a minute. Papers are due on Monday, September 22nd in the town clerk's office at 5 p.m. And they're now available. You can pick them up Monday, 7:30 a.m. to 5 p.m. and Tuesday through Friday, 7:30 to 4 p.m. And the term expires June 8th, 1998.
Any other communications? The co-curricular fee committee did meet and will be presenting a recommendation at our September meeting. Okay, superintendent's report on science curriculum workshop.
I think you're probably up to date with the progress you made before school closed at the teacher committee and other people have chosen, by looking at the learning results, have chosen material for K-6, the FOSS, full option science systems kits, and the 7th and 8th grade teachers were close to making a decision when we last left us. After school closed, 20 or 25 teachers came to the Pontoc Science Room and met with a FOSS representative to look at the kits which arrived and to get training the material and all of the logistics of managing. It became clear halfway through the first day that once people got the idea of one of the kids, I think we did probably a grade 2 and then looked at a grade 6, that the teachers were very concerned about how the material would be used, stored, placed, and so on. So with the help of the FOSS representative, we spent a good deal of time doing that. We went through each kit, inventoried all the material, and mapped out a schedule, which I can send to you in a for the next board meeting in September, that has topics now, K through 6 through FOSS, 7th and 8th through Prentice Hall, and the 9th through 12th course offering stood as they were, as they have been. So at the end of those 2 days, I think the 7th and 8th grade teachers came in for a day or two, we now have a map of all the topics in the science curriculum K through 12. In addition to that, since we're sharing materials, there's a budget consideration. We have a teacher schedule K through 6. It was particularly hard to find those because everybody teaches science and math. So at the beginning of the year, we now know what we're doing in science K through 12. I'm really pleased with the teachers. They put a lot of work into it. The 7th and 8th grade was problematic. I think they may have told you there's not a lot of good science curriculum material out nationally. But the science teachers in the middle school came and inventoried everything they had in the lab, looked at sample material for, they're not called textbooks anymore, they're parts of text, kind of modular approach, and they chose 3 or 4 for each year, looked through the lab reference material, inventoried everything they had, as you said, and then placed an order to make sure that they could actually do the lab. That was all done probably the first week after school closed. So I think they all remember that they did this. Next week, we'll be starting in earnest. And the expectation is everybody knows we're going to do it. The Learning Center in Scarborough has had considerable experience, both with the FOSS material and the other ones. And fortunately, they've been refunded. They're going to come back up and do further teacher training, or teachers go down there in the afternoon. And we hope to do parent informational workshops in the evening, so people will see what's going on.
Any questions?
Just a quick one. Are there resources made available on a daily basis for teachers that have questions at the time?
Questions about the material?
Yeah, just, you know, day by day.
Yes. Some of the teachers are now, in the kits are teacher training videos, which answer a lot of questions. And during the summer, teachers check those out. And I think they're getting at least conversant about what to do. And we could always call the Learning Center or a teacher at Scarborough. And in addition, one of our ed techs will be responsible for maintaining the Tonto science room and all the material in there. So at the end of the unit, before it goes directly from the classroom to the classroom, it'll be cycled through the science room. The consumables replaced, any kind of missing items replaced, and anything else you need to be put back in and then back in.
Great.
That looks good.
Okay.
A request of anyone who gets up to talk in the future, if you could come up here and kind of angle yourself so that your the back of your head is not. Thank you.
We're moving on to an update on the readiness of school for the opening day. We'll start with Sue Everly.
The schools will be ready. In fact, they're just about ready tonight. It's my understanding that the last of the hallways will be completed this evening, and everything will be done. Then we'll be back in the areas just sort of cleaning up and discarding of trash, because teachers are coming in and starting to unpack the classrooms and so forth. And so the number of trash runs on a daily basis have been just unbelievable. And every day there's more trash. But the buildings look terrific. If you had a chance to walk through, I think that you would agree that the staff has done an excellent job. The fields, as well as the inside of the buildings, are ready for play. We rested all of the fields this summer, with the exception of the outfield and the softball field. They've come back very nicely, and I'm happy to say we have underground watering now added to the middle school soccer field. We'll have a brand new field hockey field for the middle school team. We'll be playing on the outfield of the baseball field, and that will take a little less wear and tear on the outfield of the middle school baseball field. So all teams will have their own fields, and the fields appear to be in great condition. So the outside of the buildings are ready, as well as the inside. And I'd like to really compliment the staff for doing an outstanding job. There was a lot of team effort and a lot of coordination and working together between staff, so that, you know, things were coordinated, so we didn't have to go back and re-clean after maintenance tasks had been completed. And I think that's the reason for the high school being cleaned last. If you came in the high school about a week ago, you would swear that we wouldn't be ready for the opening of school, but all of our efforts have been focused here in the last week, and everything is done. I'm just wrapping it up, so we'll be ready for Thursday.
And Scott can comment on the, Scott Coolin can comment on the, some of the.
Some of the maintenance highlights.
The building alteration.
As everyone knows, Alan Furlon was our acting maintenance director for the course of the summer and so forth. And he did an incredible job for us. A lot of long-standing issues have been resolved. Things like some of the roof replacements on the schools, which were part of the capital improvement plan. At the middle school, we had a lot of leaks. And if anybody saw the roof on the 1930s building, the has also been replaced, the shingle roof. A lot of the underlayment was replaced, as well as the shingling on top. And as everyone knows, roofs are a sensitive issue for us. So what we did is we did a select bid list and used SMRT to write the specs on that roof and work the replacement on that. A lot of other issues that a lot of people don't see are things like the water pressure that was sprinkling the fields, which were some of the hidden pieces that, you know, were kind of behind scenes work that happened. And a lot of the tile replacements in the hallways of the high school, downstairs we did some asbestos abatement in the IA area, and just ongoing and ongoing on with our capital improvement plan. And again, as Sue mentioned, the teamwork between maintenance and custodian this year was incredible. They all worked together, they worked with the building administrators, and we had quite a team over the course of the summer. And I really would like to thank Alan Furlong, Claude Cassingway, Fred Barringer, and Bernie Shannon for that. They did an incredible job along with Sue Leonard.
Thanks. Thank you.
Update on staff changes.
And that was included in your packet. You had a list of the staff changes over the summer, with the exception of the ones that I will do under the business.
A letter from the Commissioner Albanese regarding the special education review.
As you know, our special education program received its periodic review. We had a number of recommendations and more than recommendations, mandates that we had to, changes that we had to make. And we have now been notified by the Commissioner that we have completed all of those, and he commended us for bringing our program up to total compliance.
Recognition of the acting maintenance director.
Which I think Scott just did. Just to reiterate, certainly that Alan Furlong, who was our acting maintenance director, did a wonderful job and really just catch us up on a lot of projects that have been running along for quite some time.
Long-standing aggravation. Right.
They are principals' reports. Conto first.
My testimony to the custodial maintenance group, because Conco goes first, and the building was not only kept up well, but it's been sparkling also. And we had a lot of traffic in there at one point with the responsive classroom workshop. Did a great job. Enrollment's a little bit up. I don't have the final figures yet on Conco. And needless to say, enrollment in kindergarten is up. It's probably the most pressing issue for Conco. Last year in the budget proposals, I thought that the kindergarten enrollment would peak at 18 to 20. It's currently at 22. With the, I won't say poaching, but the, with Jan Love finding a new job at the high school, it gave us a chance to look at that secretarial position, and we have decided to reconfigure it a little bit to get that person into the classroom more. So she will be helping more with the kids class, and with voicemail and other improvements at the high school, I think we'll be able to do this. For any parents who are watching this tape or here tonight, kindergarten parents, I'm not saying we've solved the problem, we're still looking at it, but I think the ed tech can help, you know, at least alleviate some concerns.
Not all classes are 22.
Kindergarten they are.
Every class is at 23.
And even had twins. The plan was to keep, the good part is, was to keep first grade enrollment down, and first grade enrollment is 18 to 20, which is pretty good. In the past 2 months, we've had no new first graders. It's been all other classes, particularly kindergarten. But part of the act of keeping first grade down was to make sure we took advantage of the help we had for make sure kids don't fall through the cracks, take advantage of the recovery work and so on. So at least first grade. During the summer, the teachers have been working both at Pond Cove and taking courses in reading and writing arithmetic. You know, with the changes in assignments from grade level to grade level within Pond Cove, teachers have taken refresher courses in Chicago math. Almost the entire second grade went to a course called Positive Classroom Discipline, which they're really excited about. And as I mentioned just a little while ago, we had a week-long responsive classroom workshop. You probably heard about individual teachers doing this. And these groups will be reporting to the faculty to see where we're going at with this information. Summer work included a writing workshop seminar that just happened this week. So leveling of reading material, which started out of the reading policy committee that we've been working on today, or continuing to do in the year. And a small group met recently to see if we get a handle on our social studies topics and curriculum, and I suspect it'll go through the same cycle as the science group. And finally, before school ended, Nancy St. John and I had a chance to at least look at and categorize by grade some of the parent survey that we did. We haven't broken it down too much, but we have some general impressions. People are pretty happy with what we've done. But just one remark about the survey itself, it doesn't seem to work as well for Pond Cove as it probably did for the middle school or the high school. A lot of the parents put down an A because it seems to be more content-driven. But we got, I think, over 200 back, which is considerable, and we'll be breaking it down and reporting it back. And I did, I'm sorry I didn't do it in the first place, but I was thinking that I probably should have given the survey to the Pond Cove staff. The survey does involve perceptions. It could have compared perceptions rather than wondering what was wrong, because I imagine that the perceptions probably match up. Okay?
Thank you. Middle school.
I really think that probably Tom, Pete, and I should have provided some kind of a dance step or routine to thank people for the state of our buildings that wouldn't have been quite so mundane, but we also thank them. Our building does sparkle. Actually, we've been looking for that, and it does happen now, and so we thank Sue and Alan and Claude and Bernie and Fred and the whole crew for all the work that they did. And certainly making it easier for people to come in and get things ready for the year. We have right now, when I left today, we had 25 new students. We did have several people who dropped in today to add to that number. Last night, the number would have been different, so I'm not sure that's what the final is. Tomorrow, we're looking forward to our new student orientation and welcoming those students and getting a tour of the building and answering at least a few basic questions of theirs. For people who might be listening to this, fifth and sixth grade homerooms will be posted on the windows by the cafeteria section Friday at 8 a.m. So people can double check and make sure exactly which homeroom they're in. All of the students do know their teaching teams, but this would be the precise homeroom so that they could have that. Earlier this evening, I was able to share with the school board members a copy of our new handbook, and certainly invite any of you, as you have a chance to read it later on, if you have questions, to please call us, and we'd be glad to answer those. In an effort to get things off to a really good start, we have already scheduled our opening day assemblies. On Tuesday, September 5th, we'll have assemblies for grades 7 and 8 and do them individually. We'll have a grade 7 one and a grade 8 assembly. And then on Wednesday, September 6th, we'll be doing assemblies for grade 6 and grade 5. One of the sections of the handbook that we'll be highlighting doing those presentations is our behavior code. This is a result of the work that was done by our behavior task force last spring. And we have several things right out in black and white. If this happens, this happens, and the consequences are clearly stated as we talk about what is expected for behavior in the middle school and what our plans are to correct any behavior that we do not find up to our standard. So we'll be spending quite a bit of time on that. Parents will also receive the first day of school. Their students will come home with the handbook. It is part of the assignment book last year. Apparently some parents didn't realize that the handbook is actually in front of where you write the assignments. There is a pledge that they're asked to sign and to get that back to school by Monday, September 8th. The assemblies will be followed up with discussions in class, and we are working on doing these in some of our content area classes, not to move them to the advisory advisee period. We want to be sure that everybody has an opportunity to discuss these and ask any questions. We'll provide answers for them. Phil Jewett and I have volunteered to go to any classes that would like to have a smaller group discussion with us than what the assembly would offer. As Tom mentioned, the surveys, I have had a chance to go through the surveys. Generally, people seem to be pleased with what we're doing. There were some good suggestions of things to work on. Be ready to give you a more complete report out on that at either the September board meeting or the workshop, whichever is the direction of the school board, and we'd be glad to share that. I do have information also recorded for individual teachers, which will be handled at meetings with me, to have a copy of their tally sheet from the report. And we did have 165 surveys returned on the sheet that I'll report out to you, 163 are noted, and that's because two people wrote straight narratives, and the tabulation sheet that I used was not able to handle that, but I do know all the things people wrote. We have that, we have it recorded, and we will use that to make improvements. We are excited to the new faculty. We're looking forward to welcoming the new faculty and staff. We have a number of people that are coming on board with us this year. I know you've already received information with that. But also, we're very excited to welcome back Paige Brown from her year of being a Fulbright teacher in France. She's had a very rich and fulfilling year and has lots of experiences to share with the students. And she has already begun sharing those experiences with the foreign language team. Buddy Earle is back from Australia. He also has a tremendous amount of information, contacts for students who are studying. And he visited in Australia. Okay. 15 years ago when he first planned this, he was going to Australia. Does that help? But Buddy is back from New Zealand, and he has lots of information about that educational system, connections for us through the internet, and information to share with teachers. So we're excited to have both of those teachers back with us. Just an update, at our June board meeting, we talked about the Outdoor Experience Task Force, which we do have on board, made up of people in the middle school. We have a representative from each grade level, and our first meeting is on September 3rd at 7 a.m. So I will keep you updated throughout the September and October board meeting with a report out at the November board meeting, as had been designed in June. And we have our curriculum nights set. The 5th and 6th grade will be presenting their curriculum on September 17th at 7. It's at least roughly 7 to 9. And the 7th and 8th grade will be presenting their curriculum September 18th. So we just have those two set up. Thank you. Anyone have any questions?
And we welcome our new high school principal, Peter, for his first report to the board.
I'd like to obviously add my thanks to the maintenance and custodial staffs. Many of the faculty members have been coming to me saying, do you think we'll be ready for the opening day of school? And I wasn't smart enough at this point to know that it was even in question. And I can see that my confidence was well placed. Everything has fallen into place very nicely. It's been a month and a half of familiarization for me. And one of the things that has really impressed me is the willingness and eagerness of faculty members. Department heads have come in a couple of times to meet with me. Individual faculty members have come in to share their summer experiences, to talk about their programs, their wishes for this year. And students have come in, delegation of senior students asked to meet with Dwight and with me to talk about their aspirations for the year. And one of the things that's been very gratifying is most of these meetings have centered on gathering impressions. And it really seems to me that we're on the same wavelength in terms of the things that are already here and the things that we want to change and try to move towards. So I have felt very good about those meetings. And I guess highlighted in that whole thing is we have, as you know, a pair of rookies in the high school. And I think Dwight and I are finding that I know that I can speak for myself in saying that I'm really looking forward to that teamwork. We have, I think, worked very well together in this formative period, and I think we fill in, we're very complementary to one another, so I'm looking forward to that relationship. The space issues that we've been dealing with, for the most part, have centered around relatively small adjustments of space. We've been addressing the issue of some of the floating teachers, those teachers who don't have a classroom of their own, finding suitable office space or room to meet the teachers and suitable teaching space that doesn't disrupt the current holders of the room. I think we've been fairly successful in meeting those. We needed to create additional space for special education. We've been sharing some space that appears to me to have been inadequate, running counter to what the classes were trying to achieve. And so we've come up with some suggestions. Those are still in process. We have figured out some ways to temporarily take care of it, and we're waiting for final okay on the more permanent solution. But I think in the end, it will give us much needed classroom space in the area of special education. We're trying to develop, wrong choice of verbs, we're trying to build a professional development library for the staff. And we have a space for it. Now we're going to start purchasing resources. We want to build an area where faculty can feel very comfortable in coming, researching issues, talking about professional issues. I think that's something that always needs to be encouraged. And right now we don't have a space that encourages that. So we're starting there. Obviously, one of the big moves was in the shift of community services from their old space to the one of the vacant kindergarten classrooms, followed by a move of the athletic director from the area that he inhabited to a much better area. That allowed for some other considerations and shifts. Not related to space, but certainly welcome additions. Scott alluded to voicemail. The new telephone system is in the process. We had some bugs at the end of the day today, but they've assured us that they're in tomorrow to try to fix those. That'll be a big improvement from what I've heard existed in the past. And also a major improvement was that Jay Trevorrow had hoped to have installed by the beginning of the school year in every classroom a computer. That looks like it's going to be, it is happening. He's had a crew of six students that have been helping in that, which has been wonderful training for them, as well as a huge help to the school system. I've been impressed with the work that they have accomplished in a relatively short period of time in bringing a computer to every classroom. Our next goal, obviously, next step will be to make sure that the faculty are feeling very comfortable in the use of those computers. Our enrollment looks like it'll be roughly the same as when we finished the school year last year. We were at 524 at the end of the school year, and we're plus or minus five of that at the moment. So we're anticipating a very similar student body that we had last year. A slight shift in where the higher numbers are. We look like we'll be a little bit higher in the 11th grade and 12th than we were last year, and a little bit lower in the 9th and 10th. Survey results were mentioned earlier. The results of the high school survey look to be very inconclusive, and we have a very small return. I haven't seen the results yet, but the number is in the neighborhood of 30 to 35 responses. So I will look at them to see if there's anything that we can grab onto and get a feeling for, but it'll be difficult to draw conclusions as a result of that type of response. On the other hand, Sharon Merrill has been surveying the class of 91 to get a feel for their thoughts about the schooling that they received at Cape Elizabeth and how it has served them in the years since. And the response there seems to be more encouraging. The last that I checked with Sharon a couple of days ago, we had received 25 responses of 103, so around 25%, which is not bad for this type of survey. We also had received 20 return to sender address unknown types of responses. But we're waiting to see if we get a few more, and then we'll be able to collate those. finally, just a heads up, I will be coming to you probably in the September meeting to apprise you of a request for a trip later in the school year. I've been approached by French teacher David Perry, who would like to reinstitute an exchange program that we have done several times over the years, and with the sponsorship of an organization that we've used over the years. And that would be a 2 to 3 week honest exchange, in that our students would go to France for this 2 to 3 week period, 1 week of which would be one of the vacations, probably the April vacation, hopefully. And the French students would come and spend that same time with the families of the students who are hosting our students for 2 to 3 weeks, centering around the February break. So it would probably be maximum of 2 weeks of school that is affected, and possibly a little bit less with a week of vacation. That type of trip, as you know, requires board approval. I will bring the details in the September meeting of the organization. It's a group called School Partners Abroad, part of the Council for International Educational Exchanges. Good reputation. The exchanges that we've held with them in the past apparently have been very satisfactory. So I'll be coming to you with more information. that's it.
I have one question, Pete, you wouldn't know this, but last year we had a little discussion with some high school students as we had different issues come up about getting a high school student to actually be a more active board rep instead of just coming and reporting at the beginning of the meeting. Has there been any more discussion about that or interest or?
Yes, when Dwight and I met with the five senior reps, one of the issues on their mind was communication with the board, and I had asked the question at that time, did they have a person coming to the meetings, and they said yes, but it was mainly to give kind of a report of activities, and then it was, and then they would either leave or stay and not say too much. Their very clear wish is to develop, they don't have the framework, and I wasn't able to suggest something right at that point, but they have the very clear wish to improve their relationship and communication with the school board.
And that was our clear wish also, but you know, it meant a time commitment by some member, and so I encourage you to develop that, and it was something as a board we were interested in.
One thing that I was going to ask, and I don't call for an answer now, but we're doing something a little bit different, a couple things a little bit differently on that first day of school, and that one, we're having all students report at 7:30 instead of the differentiated time of, it was taking me too long to figure that out, so I figured if it was taking me too long to figure it out, we needed to do away with it. So we're having all the students come in at 7:30. The second thing is that we're going to have an all-school assembly rather than just class meetings. One of the things that I was going to be talking with you about, Charlie, would be whether or not you or a member of the board would be interested in coming and speaking to the student body in that opening assembly, signaling, the content wouldn't be that important. I think it would be signaling that the board wishes to have that kind of relationship. So I'll talk with Charlie after that. But I think it's very clearly their wish, and they were talking about some ways that they might be able to. I will be working very closely with the student council. David Perry will remain the advisor, but I have assured the student council that I will be at all meetings, at least for the first half, to talk about any issues that they have in mind, and then I'll leave so that they have the freedom to talk about administrative issues.
And we may not have the framework, but contacting other towns who do it, we might be able to easily not have to reinvent the wheel. Figure out the wheel. I have just one question. It's not sort of related to Pete, but over the course of the summer, I've heard just wild rumors about the number of kids who have left Cape Elizabeth to go to other schools from 8th to 9th grade, but also within the high school community itself. Are there any firm numbers? Because I've heard numbers ranging up to, 57. I mean, there's just all kinds of numbers floating out there. It might be good to just have a
I could get the numbers from our transfer sheet. I have the numbers, but these wouldn't be a good indication of how many had left for various reasons. These are just numbers that, and I don't have last year's. I understand we have 118, roughly, that we're expecting for the ninth grade. And I think that there were in the neighborhood of 150 in the eighth grade last year.
More like 142.
142. Okay. So 24, we're down 24. Okay. Now, whether those are transfers for reasons other than moving, but I do have transfer sheets upstairs. I could get them.
That's fine. I just think there's a public perception out there that, half the class has left or whatever. So I just wanted to put that a little bit to rest.
Certainly of the ones who responded to me for exit interviews, there are not that many.
Correct.
And some of those obviously are moving away, and some are choosing other schools.
Right. Thanks.
Thank you.
We now move on to committee reports. The first is the Finance Subcommittee and the Chair Woodall.
Thank you. We met at 6:30 tonight. First, we signed warrants. We approved a shift in job title to a lead maintenance worker. I'm not sure that's the right way of saying it.
That is correct.
Okay, so there's a kind of a lead maintenance worker who would work directly with the facilities manager. We will need to approve a computer lease that has changed from our June meeting. We also approved a shift in a job title from secretary to the superintendent to an administrative assistant. We will need also to, I believe this will also be on the new business, to transfer
some money from one fund to another to cover the high school fire signage. Scott Poulin talked about the upcoming audit that we have annually, and things look like we're in good shape. That's good. We are just about at the close of the school construction project, so we could just about put that to bed. There'll be a shift of funds at the next meeting. We came in, I guess the final figure was $7,000 under budget. $7,000. For a $12 million project, that's impressive, I'd say. We have very good news concerning health insurance rates for the next couple of years. For the current year, there'll be a 0% increase in health insurance rates for our staff. And next year, we're looking for a 3% increase. So things seem to have settled down finally with insurance. We reviewed the appropriations report. And I guess this is an appropriate time to say how sorry I am to know that Scott's going to be leaving at this point. I'm new as the finance chair, and I was looking forward very much to working closely with Scott, and I'm going to miss that opportunity. Thanks for all your work over the past years. Thank you.
And we move on to the policy subcommittee. George M. Russell's the chair.
The policy subcommittee did meet on last Thursday, which was the 21st of August, 7:45 in the morning. We had a few key items that we wanted to deal with, and that we did. We basically laid out our strategy for the 97-98 policy work, kind of identified those things that would guide our work, and decided on three levels. The first level would be those policies that support some critical issues. We have actually some critical issues left over from last school year, and so we'll be focusing on some of those. The second level were to be those policies that would directly relate to the board's annual goals, and there'll be some more discussion about the board and the administrative team's annual goals for this school year. And then thirdly, those policies that would require some systematic review just because they've not been looked at in some time, or because we've discovered in conducting business on a day-to-day basis that there was some gap that exists policy-wise. At that meeting, we did not review any specific policies. However, we did set the next policy subcommittee meeting for Wednesday, September 10th. That will be at 7:45 in the morning at the Town Hall Conference Room, and we'll be looking at three policies at that time. One being promotion and retention of students. There needs to be just some minor updating of that. Student suspension and expulsion we will be dealing with, and specifically we'll be developing some guidelines around that policy, which are noticeably absent now as we struggle through some of those issues. And lastly, a policy that should pique a lot of interest is instruction time or time on task. This kind of goes back to a discussion at the end of last school year, specifically around the calendar, the school calendar, how much time is being spent on instruction and so on. And we'd like to at least get started on that. We recognize that we'll need to get the input of other groups, and that may be a more protracted effort. But those are the three areas that we will be looking at.
Thank you, George. Moving on to unfinished business, consideration of change in sabbatical leave requests for 97-98.
You have in your packet some information from Susie Van Wee, the middle school art teacher. As you know, you did approve her sabbatical for next year, next spring, and she's asking for some additional time. She's been accepted as a Fulbright scholar to spend some time in Japan in October. This would mean adding 14 days to her sabbatical request. My recommendation to you is that, since this is an extraordinary opportunity for Susie, that we do allow that but that we make it very clear that this is not a change in the district's sabbatical policy, that this is an exception because of the uniqueness of her opportunity.
Any questions?
Not a question, just I worked with Susie on her sabbatical request, and I think Cynthia's recommendation is a very good one. One thing that I think the board really needs to work on with the teachers is ways to encourage and enable our teachers to do more of these kinds of activities that will have a direct effect on the kids and teaching. And I think we should find a way to encourage somewhat unusual activities, not necessarily, you know, down the same road path that everybody usually takes in sabbaticals, and that may mean having little mini grants, little mini sabbaticals, in-house sabbaticals. I don't know. I think there are a lot of possibilities that the staff could probably come up with on their own. But I think it would behoove the board to encourage more of these kinds of activities among our teachers, and that would probably some creative ways of finding them.
Anybody else?
Cynthia and I met with Susan to go over this kind of revision of her sabbatical request, and I concur with the superintendent that I think this is exceptional, but I think it's going to bring back rewards to our system, and I totally concur with Anne that we need to encourage more of this kind of creative individual staff development, because I think that's what's going to re-energize. It's not so much going to conferences, it's just finding and getting involved in very creative new expansions of their knowledge and learning new techniques. Anyone else?
So, do we have to make a selection of the two alternatives that she gave us? Is that necessary?
Well, my recommendation is the first.
Which was our selection also, right?
That's right.
Any discussion? Two proposals. Could I have a motion?
I'd like to congratulate Suzanne and move that we accept the superintendent's recommendation.
Number one.
Option number one.
Second.
Any further discussion? Would the candidate like to say anything?
Yeah, I'd love to.
Sure, tell me.
Thanks very much. Thanks, first of all, for approving the sabbatical initially, and then coming back to you with this, which is really very much a professional in addition to this. Certainly to the opportunity to see Japanese education. And one of the things I've heard that is the most stimulating about this opportunity in Japan, one cycle has already finished, there will be, in fact, I think three a year for the next 5 years, all funded by the Japanese government. And they are planning to bring 1,000 American teachers each year for each of the next 5 years to Japan. But one of the things that I've heard is the most stimulating is the opportunity to be among other top-notch American educators from all over the country as participants. So I'll be going with 200 people from around the country, several from Ireland. Thank you very much.
Susie, one question. Do you have any ideas on a wonderful sub to replace it?
Yes, actually. I just think we need to get the ad in. I've heard that there are people out there looking for jobs.
I hope you'll work closely with that person so that the program will continue.
Yeah, for both October and spring.
Exactly.
It would be nice if we could have the same person for both.
It would be great.
Possible.
It would be great. Yeah, Nancy and I have discussed that.
Good.
Any further discussion? All those in favor? 7-0. The request to reestablish our space school study committee. I believe you have a letter.
Right, I had communicated with Michael McGovern relative to whether that should be a town school committee or just a school committee, and he did respond back, and he feels that it should be a school, strictly a school committee, but that the town council would be willing to have a representative if we so desire, and we would like to move on that. We were optimistically thinking we'd meet in August, but that hasn't happened. But I think we still may be able to make the next date, which is December, for a preliminary report. So we're looking at a representative from the town council, at least one from the school board, one from the pool committee, senior citizens, and building administrators.
And since this does impact the community services, and the community services director would essentially be an ad hoc member, we thought it might be appropriate for a member of your advisory committee to be a member of that.
Which might also be a senior citizen, Sue, or overlap? No.
Probably not.
Okay.
And I believe that Beth and I are both representatives to the same committee. I think on our own, but she's been implicit in that too. So it is it the will of the board that we proceed on and create this committee or reestablish this committee? Do I have a motion?
I'll make a motion. I move that
we reestablish the space study.
Establish or reestablish the space study committee.
Second.
Second.
Any discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor? 7-0.
We'll proceed with that, thank you.
Okay, we now move on to new business, and our first new business item is consideration for request of the acceptance of a foreign student to the high school.
And, well, Pam McNally is here, and she has a request of you. The board did have some background information. This is a situation that makes this different from other foreign students that we have discussed, is that in this case, this student is not part of an organized program, but would come through under the immigration regulations, so would be a tuition-paying student. And as the board knows, we have not had a practice of taking tuition students thus far. We do not take tuition students. And I think the other point that Pam will address you is that this, that makes this different, is that this is a student who is coming from a country where she cannot get educated, whereas most of the foreign students that we've had in the past are looking for a different type of education or an American education, but this student is coming from a situation where she is not able to be educated.
Yep, that's, I don't know what you would like me to say about that,
or maybe people have questions as well. This is a student who has been living with her.
Yeah, she lived with us on last semester, the spring semester, and she went to Macaulay and did very well. She speaks English better than probably any of us speak Albanian. And she's, you know, socially wonderful. She's been in our family. She lived with my family. And she's the same age as my oldest daughter, who's a senior at Cape Elizabeth. And that's one of the reasons that she would like to come to Cape, is because, you know, she already has a, you know, somewhat in high school that she knows. And I would stress that, you know, she's in a very, it's a very unsettled country. It's Serbia. If you read the insert that was submitted, it talks about what it's like for an Albanian Muslim child going to school in Serbia. And it's quite horrific. They stray for community routinely, fire shotguns, and, you know, she lives in a very unpleasant environment. So her parents would really like her to get a high school education, because you have to take a test in order to get into college. Once you pass the test and get into college, you're sort of in an open space. Her older sister is going to college, and so she's pretty set. But the kids who are still trying to get a high school equivalent type education in order to pass, you know, the test to get into college are at a real disadvantage. The schools that she can go to are underground schools, which are, you know, not exactly a safe situation. And so that's why her parents would like to, you know, send her abroad and would like to send her here. You know, so I would really implore you to think about this seriously. She'll be living with us. We're already accepting her as our responsibility. We communicate with her parents regularly. So in that sense, you know, that comes.
How was the connection?
Well, Well, the connection was made because Fizar was a student. I can't think of Fizar's last name. He came to the U.S. A woman named Alice Mead, who wrote the book that I took the excerpt from, did a journey to, she journeyed to Kosovo, and she has brought many young men. Because what happens to the young men is they are recruited into the army, into the Serbian army, and sent to dangerous duty, and most of them are killed. And it's very sort of in a subtle, terroristic way. And they go, oh, gee, it was an accident. So most of the young men in her country, in Kosovo, which is an Albanian province, have fled the country. She talks, and her family talks a lot about how the villages are deserted, and that there are no, people living in the villages, and a lot of people have exited her country. So Vizar came to America through this woman, Alice Mead, and came to Cableton High School. And that was before the immigration law was passed last fall, which said that people who are coming into the country and using our public education system need to pay for it. So that law was passed last September. So when Kiki wanted, her parents wanted to send her to America for the school, she didn't fall under, she had to obey the new law, which was passed last fall. And that's, it's a really strict law about public education. She could go to Macaulay, but Macaulay is Catholic. She's a Muslim. They were very respectful of her, but they also would like her to spend 2 years at Macaulay, and she would like to work with Mrs. Merrill on completing, because she is a senior. She's the same age as Karen, and could, you know, continue to graduate from high school this year. That's what her goal is, to not come here, you know, 2 or 3 years to graduate. I know that's also a battle I need to read with, to talk about what kind of courses she needs to take to get her. First, I need to get her here first to have that discussion.
There was no professional organization that she could connect with to sponsor her?
Not that works in this area. I mean, a lot of the kids who are here in the Portland area are from Bosnia, and they have been refugees who have fled, you know, Sarajevo and, you know, the Bosnia, Croatia, Herzegovina area. She's not in that section. She's in more Serbia, which hasn't had the war-torn peace like, you know, Sarajevo has, but is still very desperate for the Albanians.
So she is here on a visa?
Yeah, she would come on a student visa, which is what she came on last January. When she lived with us, we did the 23 McCall, and she came on a student visa for one semester.
Pam, do I understand correctly that at the end of the school year, she returned to Bosnia?
Yeah, not to Bosnia, to Kosovo, which is in Serbia.
I'm sorry, Serbia.
You know, under, you know, our State Department rules, she could do political asylum. But she's from, you know, the intelligentsia part of her society. Her parents and people, you know, in her circle are, you know, the people who used to run the government and used to be the professors and the lawyers and the doctors and in the community. And so they have a big stake in making political change. And so they don't, you know, they don't want to emigrate to America. You know, they want to do this. You know, push their country toward democracy and, you know, self-government and all that kind of stuff. So that's, it's not a question of using the political asylum and coming here as much as it is given, you know, getting the high school education so that she can, you know, pass the tests to get into college and then it's going to go to college.
Have you had a conversation with Sharon at all as to whether or not she did?
I didn't want to do that until I found, I mean, I, you know, it was a big step for her family to, you know, commit to $6,800. I mean, I needed to have them, you know, I talked to, I think it was probably Scott, about the per pupil expenditure, and, you know, and talked to the parents in a really concrete way about, can, is this something you want to do? That's a lot of money. So, you know, I just, and I know school starts next week, but they had a lot of decisions to make this summer.
How old is she?
She's 17. She turned 17 in July.
So for her to live here, even under student visa, because she is not of legal age, does she require temporary guardianship?
No. Because it's not, I mean, we didn't do any of that last year. And her parents are, you know, that you can do faxes and, you know, you can talk to them. They call us. We can't have that all works.
I guess my only issue with it is we have two policies that we would be violating. Again, you don't want to be too rigid with your policies, but we are trying to have a school that we do follow policies. And I don't know what the answer to it is. We have one policy that we don't take tuition students. And the second issue is that for our foreign exchange student policy, we take them from accredited programs. And that's my battle. It's
absolutely... I totally hear your battle, and I understand. I think that this is a different, this is not the same issue as coming here for a cultural experience.
Yeah, no, I agree.
So what I would like you to put into your equation to think about your dilemma is to make this is an exception, so that it's not something, you know, so that someone from Scarborough can't say, well, you accepted this person from Gothenburg for tuition. I mean, it's not the same thing. Scarborough has public education. This, you know, they're not, you know, in, you know, threat of losing their life as they walk down the street to school. And, you know, I mean, it's just not the same situation. So on the court that the exception to
Yeah, so she would not qualify for a program.
There's no program
there's
that
not,
operates.
Kind of,
yeah, I mean, it's not right. It's not like there's an option. I think if there was a program, it would be wonderful. But when I look at, you know, Alice Mead and I both have thought about starting a program, but programs don't address the issue of getting a diploma and getting an education. You know, I mean, when we have someone coming from Spain this year to the high school, you know, that person is not coming here, you know, to participate in and get a diploma from Tablesworth High School. That person is coming for a cultural experience, and, you know, then they have to go back home and make up or whatever, the same, you know, to comply with their school rules for graduating, you know, from the high school that they're from in their country. You know, so it's not really, it doesn't solve the problem for her, you know, and so a program isn't, it's the way that the programs are written, you know, in the law with, you know, the Congress and immigration, all that, just really get her situation.
You're going back to what I understood from the meetings. She would be well and fully accepted back at Macaulay in September.
Right.
So she is able to get a U.S. terror-free education.
But she can't.
Regardless.
Right, but she doesn't want to go.
It's, you know, it's laudable, the support you have given this young woman. She's very glad to have you as an advocate. As far as making an exception, I guess it's my feeling that we developed this policy and just revised it with a lot of effort just this past winter, because these situations are not very unique anymore. I mean, we have had a student here in a similar situation, and the high school did ask us for very specific guidelines, because it's very, very easy to get you know, mesmerized and very sympathetic about an individual situation, but there's so many out there that the only way you can really protect yourself and make sure you're being fair to every person who comes forward is to have very specific guidelines like this. And while we don't, I didn't know she wanted to graduate from here, but we also have been working on that issue over the past couple of years about, you know, what the requirements are to graduate from Cape Elizabeth High School. And it just seems to me that, you know, we put a lot of thought into these policies just lately with situations very similar to this in mind. And the best protection for us, to be fair, follow our policy, and this young woman does have another alternative, which is great for her. But you know, this is only lots of exceptions and lots of nuances, and I think we have a good policy.
recognizing the policy, but speaking from a perspective of having been in international schools where we have students from many different backgrounds and having worked with many students who are in similar situations on hardship basis, I can't tell you how much, from a selfish standpoint, how much that having a student with this type of background does in terms of all of our learning. We have very little idea the type of suffering that's going on in that part of the world, even when I was living 6 hours away from it. And the type of gain that we could make as a school from having a student participating with us, and I think the types of gains that we could offer to that student would be immense.
I just have a couple of other questions, Pam, and perhaps you could help. She does have full competency in English, because she speaks
Italian.
English better than we would speak Albanian.
Well, I mean, she speaks five languages, including English. I mean, she took English, second semester English at Macaulay and Tukasi, which I think, given the fact that she'd never left her country and was new to the environment, was pretty amazing. I mean, we are a very wealthy community, and it appalls me a bit to think that we would say no to this and say, well, yes, she can go to Macaulay. I mean, she could go to Wayne Fleet. That's just not the point. The point is that I've lived here, and I pay taxes here, and I would like to be proud of my people. And I think this is a worthy piece. I'm not asking to have five students from Serbia come here and go to school, she's willing to pay, and I think that I really appreciate this.
Gina, do we know how many exchange students we have enrolled for this academic year?
I believe two at the present time.
Two. This policy limits it to four.
Right. Just one more comment on a historical note, and this may seem tangential, but it really isn't. Several years ago, we stopped allowing our staff members to enroll their kids here if they didn't live within the district. And we don't let them bring them in if they want to pay. I still think that was the right decision for Cape Elizabeth, hard as it was, and I know it's been hard on a lot of our staff. Again, that's another reason why I think we just need to be consistent with all, with all due respect to the wishes of one family, I think. Sticking with them both.
I guess I just have one other comment. If I am to support this, I would have to feel that Sharon isn't under pressure to make any exceptions in our requirements.
I have no intent to pressure.
Because we had some discussions about a year or so ago as we were going over this foreign policy that a high school diploma from the United States is worth a lot in a lot of places, and that we didn't want to feel like they were for sale, that we made exceptions and didn't.
Well, this isn't, a unique thing to this to the Greater Portland community. Greeley and Deering both issued diplomas to these students from Kosovo last year.
It's fine. So, I just want to
want you to know that it's not something that has not been done.
Yeah. No, I just, that we don't, that if it takes 2 years for her to get a diploma, which is what Macaulay's saying, that...
And that's what, if that's what Sharon says, that's what Sharon said, then I have no, I don't wish to help hear the stories. She needs to hear that. She needs to hear that. And part of what goes on for her in her country is a dual society, very similar to what the Jews went through in Nazi Germany, because they think, she will talk about Kosovo, on the one hand, as being this wonderful place and she can't wait to get home, and then she'll tell you in the very next sentence about finding one of her friends standing in the street. I mean, it is very incredible to be around someone who lives in this kind of situation. I mean, we have no concept what it's like to be a Jew. So she tends to sometimes have lots of sort of fantasies about what she can do. And if Sharon says it has to be 2 years, then it has to be 2 years. And she may make a different choice. But, I'm not, in the business of pressuring Sharon to do something that she needs to do what she needs to do.
And my battle is, when we make an exception to a policy for this, what if we already had our four exchange students and you were coming to us with the fifth one? Would you make the exception for the fifth one? What if we had a teacher circumstance where, you know, they wouldn't pay tuition? It gets hard. You know, and it seems
But that's
to me,
what your job is.
Yeah,
your
exactly. Job is Believe me, I know.
She knows. I mean, I'm asking you to do a hard job.
Yes.
And I think that being rigid around rules is something I don't try to be in my job or my parenting or whatever. I think that there are reasonable exceptions that can be made.
Can I just point out that we specifically, just so people are aware, I can't remember who was at those meetings, but yeah, a lot of people talking about these very kinds of situations and trying to make it very clear to people what our expectations were, so that people wouldn't have to know. This was February. This was just February, and we were dealing with case studies very much like the one that you're talking about, the boy who had come over to avoid military service, and trying to deal with those just in a fair way. So I think it's unfair to the board to say, you're giving us the hard job to do. We went through a lot of hard work to develop that policy in fairness to everybody.
Pam, you're right. This is a real tough decision. And emotionally, I have one opinion, and intellectually, I have another opinion. However, it seems clear to me that he is able to come to the United States and to obtain a good, solid education, and that the criteria for that education has been laid out. And I suspect that if McCauley is saying it's 2 years, there are people who are going to come back with basically the same assessment of the situation. If this was a matter of smuggling PP out of that part of the world to save her life and she would be here permanently, then I would absolutely oppose rigidness on the part of the policy. But it seems to me that if you're telling me she's pending in, she's gone back, she's coming back again, she has pretty clear freedom of movement. And there is an education available to her, and probably, I believe, a very good education available to her. And I think it's real tough to play on our emotions in terms of making us feel that this is saving her life when in fact it's not.
She could choose, she has to choose.
Recognizing she cannot get an education in her own country, she is able to get an education in this country, in this state, in this region.
Okay, the will of the board. Does someone want to propose a motion, rule of motion? If not, it lies.
I would like to make the motion that we accept this hardship request for admission into the high school. It would be a paid tuition as required by the immigration laws, as proposed here by Pam.
Do I have a second?
I'll second.
Any further discussion?
I can't support the motion. I think it's been well stated in reference to the availability of an education either at Wayne Fleet or McCauley. I don't wish to violate our policies that the school board has worked diligently to put into place. And I think we lose a lot that's been gained over the last couple of years. So coming to this situation where we've been supporting the policies made by our committee.
I think that I think that policies are very, very important, and they really help to guide us in most situations. But in some situations, we have to look at principles. Principles sort of are bigger than policies. And in this particular instance, while I recognize this young woman has some other options, they're not the options that she would wish to pursue, or perhaps. perhaps the options that would be really in her best interest. As happily as the new chairperson of the policy committee, I'm very excited about my role and believe strongly in the power of policies, but also recognize that the world is not black and white. And this situation I think that Pam's bringing in front of us is really not a black and white situation. Having gone through the experience of having a young man from a different country spend part of the summer with us, I guess I kind of took for granted that it was going to be okay or kind of fun or good for them, and didn't realize just what a significant and powerful impact it would have, not only on my children, but us as a family, and a very positive, significant impact. I think that what Peter spoke to is something that we shouldn't dismiss all too quickly. We're looking at extending something out to this young woman, but at the same time, we're also looking to bring a bit of reality, a bit of the reality of the world to strengthen our school community. And I think that the incredible benefit that we may gain, I almost look at this selfishly, to say that what we may gain and what some of the students and folks that come into contact with this young woman may gain, it's going to far outweigh the fact that we're making an exception. I don't see it as a hardship, an exception. She's not eligible for any other programs. So right there, she couldn't possibly sort of comply with this policy that we've laid out. I guess that's why I made the motion and my strongly support.
Can I ask one more question? Have you approached any of these programs to see if she could be a part of that program, even if she's from a different part of the
country?
I thought we just had a couple that we really working with or something.
Well, there are a large number of approved ones, but you're right, Rotary and International Youth Exchange. There are just a couple that we tend to have experience. But there are a number that are approved by immigration.
But they're not, here to.
It'll be too late for her to link up with one of those for next year.
I kind of have to kind of agree with George. I think we live in a very homogeneous community, and I think our students are exposed to a lot of the real world. And I think this is part of their education, is being exposed to students from other countries. I think the type of students we get are more cultural, so it's coming from similar kind of economic backgrounds and have a lot of freedom of movement. And I think the student coming from the war-torn area of the world that we read about and see on the news would bring it a more realism. And I see this more of an education for the students than just an education. And I would support this.
Having worked on these policy issues the whole time I've been on the board, I have to say it's really discouraging to me how much time and effort we put into adopting these policies, consulting with various parties. We've worked on this policy for 2 years, and there are lots of exceptions out there, but there are lots of pitfalls out there. This may turn out to be a perfect situation. We've had exchange student issues that have not gone well for either the students or whatever. And one way that we were trying to protect everyone involved was to work through particular programs. I'm sorry if that sounds culturally unenlightened of me. I actually think I'm pretty enlightened and believe that it's good for the kids to have exposure to a lot of people. But we have to look at devising policies that are fair, consistent, and that don't change every time someone, brings a special request to us. I think this is a well thought out, coherent policy that protects students, families, and the board. And it worries me when I see the board being willing to just make one exception here or there, because there are lots of cases that if you just take them one at a time, it sounds doable, but you're creating a precedent, and it's, and you're going to spend more and more time, not only on this issue, but other issues. Every time you create an exception, you're going to spend more and more time working on people who are asking for exceptions and not doing the business of the board. We just put this policy in place, and then the first request we have, you know, we're willing to override it. It's got to ask the question, why, what's the point of having policies?
That's a good question.
What, that we shouldn't have policies? We should just have everyone do business with the school system by coming forward and asking us for things? How will we ever educate the kids and get our job done? I mean, we've spent 25 minutes on this. I'm not saying this kid isn't important. What you're doing is great for this kid. But as a school system, I don't think this is a good way to run the school system.
Even having policies that say we only go with approved programs, we have had Fulbright exchanges with teachers that are approved programs that have not been successful for us. Successful with the teachers that's gone abroad, but not successful for us. So there are gray areas, even in approved
and you were just
programs.
Doing that
just
in the earlier part of the agenda. You were saying that you should find more creative and unique and different types of sabbaticals for teachers.
That's,
so you're willing.
That's correct. But that's a different area. We've just worked, you know, for years on this policy. So I don't want to argue with you, but it's just that we discussed, and I wish Sharon was here and Rick was here, because we worked very hard on devising a fair policy that addressed a lot of these specific issues that you're talking about. And it's not that each individual situation we come up against this a lot. Things that people would like from the school system. And we can't continue to operate unless we have clear policies. I'm just frustrated because this is an area where we happen to have a clear policy that we've just put in place with these kinds of situations directly in mind when we did it. And everybody voted on it and it was accepted. And then we're undoing it. So just my personal frustration and my fault with the question.
I have a thought for me with the question. All those in favor of the motion? All those opposed? Four. You're welcome. We now move on to consideration of resignation from the business manager.
No, we have three. I have three teacher resignations. I have three resignations, and these are confirmations of resignations we received over the summer. One is Karen Rand, who was a special education teacher at the middle school. Rebecca Wing, who was a part-time music teacher at the middle school, and Claudine Brava, who was a foreign language teacher at the middle school.
Do we have a motion?
I move that we accept the resignation.
Second.
Charlie, can I just say something?
Yes.
Maybe afterwards.
Is it concerning this?
It's just a comment from us.
Well, I think you should, we should concern it before.
It's not a concern, Charlie, it's just a
Your comment or commentary?
Okay. I just wanted to make the commentary that these people have all gone on to other things, but since they all come from the middle school, I wanted people to know that we had really enjoyed working with all of them, and they enriched our faculty and our student experience during their time with us. Claudine Bravo is a person who worked with us for 3 years. She is fluent in 5 languages and brought a lot of cultural background and enrichment to our foreign language program, as well as her teaching. Karen Rand was with us for a very short time, but worked with us in special education, and then she came on board last November, I believe, at the November board meeting, I think is when we nominated her. And she worked with our 6th grade last year in special education and did an outstanding job, and came on and really worked well with those students. And Rebecca Wing has worked with us for 7 years as part of our music department. She has been an invaluable part of that program. One of the enjoyable things about working with music educators is that they're very creative, they're very individualistic, they have their own personalities. Rebecca Wing is a very accomplished musician herself. She is going to do very well in her own career. We know that. She has several CDs out, and she's working on her 2nd one, I guess, to be correct. She brought expertise to the classroom, but also she worked very well with her colleagues in helping move our music education forward. So, wanted to say that we enjoyed working with them, and we'll miss all 3 of them, and we
wish them well in their endeavors.
All those in favor? 7-0.
With regret, I wish to recommend that you accept the resignation of Scott Pullman, business manager.
Motion?
With regret, I move that we accept the superintendent's recommendation.
A second?
A second.
Any comment?
Well, a little later tonight, I'm going to be making some comments about the good things that have gone on in the past few years, and Scott is certainly one of those good things. He has done just an outstanding job as business manager for us. He certainly has been accessible to the board and helpful answering our requests, explaining things, and just getting everything to run smoothly. And I personally enjoyed being able to attend the negotiation workshop at Harvard with him. He was a very active participant. I'm sure he'll be very helpful to his new district with that training.
We have a contract up this year.
Right.
We have noticed that our two people are going to the Harvard negotiations.
I know, that weighs heavily on them.
It does.
But anyway, Scott, I'm gonna miss working with you. Goodbye.
Come up to your table.
I'd like to thank Scott for his time and patience in walking through some of the issues of school finance. I'm well versed in corporate finance, and I've discovered that school finance is an entirely different world. Scott, thanks for your time and help.
I just wanted to add my thanks, Scott. You and I started at the same time.
We did.
And so we've been here the same amount of time, and I have enjoyed working with you the whole time. And I have nothing to compare you to, but all I can say is it's been wonderful.
Just briefly, I want to thank Scott for his presence in the building. It's one thing to do the ledger well and balance the books, but to be around and know we're doing well. He made it remarkable.
Oh, dear.
Oh,
dear.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Once again, we probably should have got together and done a song or something. I would have broken up the monotony of it, but certainly not monotonous stuff. To thank you for your time, for your effort, all of the good things that people have said, but also, too, for helping us through different budget process and combining some things and making things simple as they can be, but specific and clear and direct has certainly been helpful. And he's always been willing to answer our questions. Even when I ask him the same question more than one time, he's very patient and always provides us with good information. So we wish you well from the middle school, and I certainly wish you well personally for myself. And thank you for your time here and your efforts with us.
Having just finished 4 years as finance chair, such like Scott's tenure here, and having been one of the people that interviewed and hired him, I've had a very close working relationship with him, and he has always used me as a sounding board, and I hope that he will do the same for his new chair and his new position. Knowing over the last 8 years how the central office and how organization disarray we were in, and to see what has come about in 4 years, and to see looking at audits over the years, and to come to a year where we have very, 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 very few inadequacies in our audit, it is all due to Scott's administrative skill. We will move on from the practice of the okay, all those in favor, with regret, 7-0.
And also with regret, we have the resignation of Jay Trevorrow, who has not been with us very long, but certainly has made a very positive impact during his time here.
Entertain a motion.
I move that we accept the resignation of Jay Trevorrow.
Second. Once again, having been one of three who interviewed and hired Jay, and having worked with Jay when he worked for the Maine Center in helping us to develop a technology, even to get somewhere of developing some kind of a cohesive
technology plan or plan of action. And the vision that we saw has more than fulfilled what the three of us need to be doing and then hiring expected. And we will be missed, but I think in 1 year we're further along than we were a year ago. So the successor will have a much easier road.
Actually, I also worked with Jay back on the committee that Charlie talked about when he was working as a consultant. And just in the last year as a building administrator working with Jay, I think he's a person who accomplished a great deal in a short amount of time, and we sincerely thank him for that. We are further ahead on that plan than the one time I thought possible. A lot of credit goes to him. I know he spent many, many hours here in this system. Weekends, and I don't think he ever beat Mary Bruns to work, but I know sometimes they walk in together, and that's a very early hour in the morning, so we will miss him, and I wish him well in his next job. Thank you for the time.
I worked with Jay ever since he started here. He's a really cool guy to be around. I can remember cold, frosty February vacation mornings. I'd get there 8 o'clock in the morning, and we'd work in wiring closets together, and you know, and it was a really neat experience. I've learned a lot from him, and you really gonna miss him. Great guy.
I think what was good about Jay is he utilized all our resources, and our resources were students with expertise, and he utilized other institutions. SNTC, he did what I think education is all about, involving the whole community. And I wish him luck. All those who,
yeah. He was also had an infectious personality, an energetic, can-do attitude, which is just great to see. A guy who could have been, you know, moping around at the magnitude of the little drony tasks he had to do at times. He always had a smile on his face.
Okay, all those in favor? 7-0.
With pleasure, I wish to nominate Kathy Van Dorn as a special education teacher. She comes to us very highly recommended, and we're pleased to have her. She'll be at the high school.
Entertain a motion.
I move that we accept the recommendation, superintendent's recommendation of Kathleen Van Dorn.
A second. Any discussion? I would like to make one comment, and because it's special ed, a comment made by our special ed director when all these resignations are coming in, and she was saying, I hope it's not because I come on board that people, that I'm giving a certain comment that everybody's leaving. I don't believe it. They are all moving on to something bigger and better. You moved on to something bigger. Okay, all those in favor? 7-0.
I have several fall athletic position nominations. David Eklund to be 8th grade boys soccer coach. Sarah Jordan to be 7th grade girls soccer coach. And Sean Russo to be varsity ice hockey coach. And you can do them either separately or together, whatever you wish.
I just want to ask a question at the comments. I was concerned about Sean Russo's age, a junior at Bowdoin College. Is there any?
The hockey parents assisted in locating and recommending this young man to Keith Buckley. I believe Keith was duly impressed. Hockey parents were duly impressed. I have met him on several occasions, including parents' meetings. And at the ice arena during summer hockey. I am extraordinarily impressed with this young man's maturity. His stated attitude about the ice hockey team is that they represent themselves first as students. They represent the Cape Elizabeth High School second, and they represent the town of Cape Elizabeth third, and that they will uphold that reputation, a solid reputation, as they move out to play. play ice hockey, I am again extraordinarily impressed. His hockey background is absolutely impeccable, and I believe it's the consensus of the Parents Association, as well as Keith, since we were not trying to dictate to him, that this is an absolute plus for the hockey program in Cape Elizabeth.
I guess I would just want to be sure he has lots of support from Keith, and just so that there aren't, you know, misunderstandings.
There has also been a strong commitment on the part of the parents group, very strong.
Parents can also be the strongest.
We can be dangerous.
That's right. Not just in hockey.
In all sports.
That's right. So. Okay. Entertain a motion to accept all of them together, or? You
know, I'll make a motion that we accept the superintendent's recommendation of David Eklund, Sarah Jordan, and Sean Russo.
Have a second?
Second.
Any further discussion?
Just one question. Is the fall like full now? Do we have coaches for all positions?
In the high school, I think we're set. I do believe that there's a middle school position.
There are several middle school positions.
I think soccer. So we have one boys coach and one girls coach. Okay, we need one more boys coach and one girls coach.
What happens with that? When are practices supposed to start?
Practices don't start until after school starts. I think when we met last week with Keith, we covered up. It obviously will depend upon when we have coaches. We're hoping to have some practices, I think, beginning the first Thursday, which is September 4th. Thank you. He has been advertising a couple of times throughout the summer.
There won't be time to come to the board if practices do start that Thursday, so I assume that there'll be some revision today.
Yes.
Middle schools are the hardest positions. At the time. Any further discussion? All those in favor? 7-0.
I have a number of co-curricular fee positions. Do you want me to go through all of them, or do you want to do them one by one? Let me show the question.
Just put them.
Okay. For natural helpers, we have Andrea Kier and Katie Lisa. Student Advisory Council, David Perry. Theater Class Productions, Dick Mullen. Fall Drama Performance, Dick Mullen. Spring Drama Performance, Dick Mullen. Yearbook, Diane Brakely. Literary Magazine, Sarah Franklin. Book Talk, Joyce Bell. And Cultural Exchange Club, Bill Brewington. And obviously we still have vacancies that will come forward as time progresses. I have another side to the paper. No wonder. Oh, we have, these are team leaders positions, basically. For kindergarten, Ted DeMille. First grade, Nancy Rollis. Second grade, Wendy Martin. Third grade, Barbara Powers. Fourth grade, Jill Bell. Allied Arts, Judy Ferranti. Team leader, special ed, Susie Safer at K-4. Moving on to the middle school, we have team leader for grade 5, Bruce Lind. Team leader for grade 6, Joe Doan. Team leader for grade 7, Craig Roberts. For grade 8, Therese Roberts. Special ed middle school, team leader, Tammy Thatcher, who was Tammy, that's a new name. Tammy Stanley, right. Not a new person, just a new name. Team leader, team facilitator is Anine Burgess. Foreign language, Suzanne Janelle. Moving to the high school, IA is Gary Lanoy. English, Sally Martin. Guidance, Sharon Merrill. Fine arts, Mary Hart. Foreign languages, Judy Liberty. Social studies, Ray Cooper. Math, Elaine Brownell. Science, Bill Brewington. Health, Andre Kier. Special ed, Tina Johnson. And research coordinator, Joyce Bell.
I would like Nancy to explain to the rest of the board the team facilitator, that there's a change recommended by the co-curricular committee.
And this position actually goes with our allied arts team that had been a full team in our middle school. In discussions with them throughout the latter part of last year, they really felt that that was not the best
way for them to organize, and they are attaching themselves to grade level teams. However, there are times when they want to meet together. The position before was at the same stipend as the other team leaders. Their recommendation was that we begin to call this, and they didn't know exactly what to call it. They decided they were comfortable with team facilitator. That person will be attending our team leaders meeting and will be responsible for communication for the Allied Arts team throughout the year, especially around budget time and a few other times that they will be meeting. So that's why we recommended to the co-curricular committee that it come in at a stipend of $500. And we don't know if that's the right stipend or not. That's the stipend the team was comfortable with for this year. We will look to see how much time it takes and the duties that it encompasses throughout the next year.
Nancy, what about the additional pieces that I handed out to finance committee? Do you want the action taken on those?
Yes, I thought.
Okay, I handed out an extra sheet at the finance committee meeting. In error, I didn't get that out to the board. We brought the board package, but there are some additional positions there.
Ready for those nominations?
We're ready for those nominations.
All right, instructional music, Tony Baffa, chorus, Joanne Lee, student council, grades 5 through 8, Julie Salikas and Paige Brown, drama, which is middle school drama, Nancy, correct?
Yes,
Stephen Price, computer, middle school again, Beverly Bisbee, art, Susie Van Wee, and sign chorus, Gail Parker. And again, there are still a number of vacancies in those positions as well.
That's right. And the change that Scott was talking about is that for our 96-97 school year, we had a total of 945 hours. For this year, with our things that what we're adding is debate, and we also reduce some of our other things, it comes to a total of an increase of 45 hours that we're asking for, as recommended by the co-curricular committee.
We'll get the full co-curricular report in September. Actually, Nancy is to be commended because she's showing an increase, but in actuality, with her team leader decrease, she has actually created some hours for the system. Yeah.
A question in reference to art. The individuals are going to be on sabbatical. Does that still hold true that that amount is to be paid?
Yes, because that's actually, John, for a program we call Art Friday, and it starts mid to late November and is usually over by late February, early March. And Susie will not be going out on her sabbatical until the third trimester, which starts about the third week of March, and she will be back from her visit to Japan prior to the beginning of Art Friday, and we'll certainly get those hours in, those hours and more by the time she's done.
Any discussion? Entertain a motion.
I move we accept the nominations as presented by the superintendent.
Second.
Second.
Any further discussion? All those in favor? Okay. Consideration of a tax-exempt lease purchase agreement. This is an agreement that we passed at our last meeting in June, but because of change in total amount, we have to
read. I move we accept the following lease. The superintendent of schools may be and hereby is authorized to execute and deliver a tax exempt lease purchase agreement with People's Heritage Leasing Corp. in the name of and the name and on behalf of the town of Cape Elizabeth by and through its school committee for computer and related technology with an aggregate purchase price of $117,873.
Second.
Second.
Any discussion? All those in favor? 7-0. Transfer of funds. Scott, I need to help you.
Okay. Want me to give you a motion?
Yes, please.
Transfer from 9020-4730. Is the account number, the sum of $35,000. Transfer the remaining amount to 9075-1000.
What was the first account number?
The first account number was to remove from 9020-4730, the sum of $35,000, and move that $35,000 9003-3430.
Yeah, those are accounts.
Those are account numbers.
Of what are the accounts?
Okay, the account number. You're moving from school bus purchase transportation to the $35,000 to contract building repair. Okay, and then you're taking the remainder of that school bus purchase line and transferring it to the school department contingency account. But you'll need the account numbers in there. Yes. For the town charter.
I move we transfer the funds from account 9024730, school bus purchase in the amount of $35,000 to contract building repair, account number 9075-1000, as well as an additional $17,000 from the school bus purchase line to 9003-3430, which is designated fund.
It's backwards.
Contingency.
I have a right to that.
Yeah, you keep it right in the minutes. Just
the reason for the transfer?
Yeah. The reason for the transfer is that the high school has about $30,000 to $35,000 worth of signage, fire signage, that the fire chief would like to see us replace. It's old signage from 1960. Half of it doesn't work, and we did not make that part of our capital improvement plan. We purchased a school bus out of our remaining fund balance in last year, so we're actually one bus up on our capital replacement plan on school bus. So we'll just transfer that. I would suggest at the end of this fiscal year, looking at where you're at, maybe purchasing the bus.
Do we have a second?
Second.
Oh, John's willing to second that one.
Very clear the way I explained it.
Any discussion? All those in favor? 7-0. Consideration of a resignation. Well, let's take the business manager.
Just got it.
No, take the business manager nomination first.
I wish to nominate Paulina Portria to the position of business manager for a 1-year contract.
Move we accept the superintendent's recommendation for business manager.
Second. Do you want to give any history?
She's a long-term business manager, so she'll come to us ready to hit the deck running, which is what we want and need. And I will guarantee you great accuracy on her figures, which is one of the main criteria.
And having served on the interviewing committee along with the town manager and Cynthia, we had three very viable candidates, and she was the strongest of all of them with school experience. Comes with a strong recommendation. Some of them we all know. Okay, all those in favor? 7-0.
And I do have one other addition to the agenda. Although we discussed at a school board workshop the boys' soccer trip to Connecticut, we never really officially approved it. And you do have the final piece tonight, which is the list of students. So for the record, if you can approve that trip.
When is that? When was that trip?
No, it's coming up.
Day after tomorrow.
Okay. You had all the other information except for the roster.
I make a motion that we accept the recommendation for the boys' soccer trip.
It's an out-of-state Connecticut trip, so that's why we need board approval. Do we have a second?
Second.
Any discussion?
I just want to say thank you to Andy for getting us the complete information. I know we couldn't do the last week from now, but we did get the complete information about what the trip parameters are.
There is a recommendation that a standardized form be established now that we have a cohesive athletic department with a secretary, I would suggest.
We'll talk to Deb right now about that.
It would make it easier, so all the pieces, even though it's in a policy, at least it would be in a form for something else to be used. This is probably the
probably one of the easiest years we've ever had to improve, because everything was there. All those in favor. And our last piece of business for this evening is the consideration of a resignation of a board member.
It was me. Everyone knows at this point I have given Charlie and Cynthia my letter of resignation, which is effective at the end of this meeting. I have taken a job with Maine School Management Association as their policy and resources specialist, and it starts on September 2nd. And for those of you who don't know what Maine School Management Association is, I'm finding out a lot of people don't. They're like the service organization for school boards and superintendents in the state who do all kinds of education programs. And one of my main jobs will be to help school boards like this work on their policy books. That's why I feel, as everyone can see, that I feel very strongly about the power of policy to structure what we do and to guide us, particularly when we're dealing with very difficult, sensitive situations where there's so many ways to go. If you have good, strong policies, I think it protects everybody in the end. I'd just like to say a few words. I've been on the board for just over 6 years, and sometimes when you're in the day-to-day work of the board, you tend to focus on the crisis of the moment, and of course there are a lot of them. But since I actually applied for this job and accepted it, I've given quite a bit of thought to how much progress this district really has made in the past few years, and I'm proud to have been a part of that. Obviously, the new school building is the most tangible big thing that we've done, and I am very proud of that building and the part I played in that. But there have been a lot of other changes that aren't that tangible sometimes to the public, or they take a long time to come to fruition and people start to take them for granted. One of the major ones was when I came on the board, there were a lot of issues with the reading program at Pond Cove. And looking back over these years, that issue has really been addressed. And I think the kids are doing well with their reading program, and we have a reading policy system-wide, and I think we address that issue. We have a math curriculum in place. The technology piece is up and running. We still obviously have curriculum work to do, but that's ongoing. We have a new science curriculum that's about to go into place. We've hired a tremendous group of administrators and teachers over the past few years, and we should all be very proud of them. I certainly enjoyed working with them. The business and maintenance pieces, again, invisible to most of the public, but they were in total disarray a few years ago. And everything is running so smoothly, and it's so easy to take that for granted. But if people just think back to the opening day of school several years ago, if things aren't going well, you can have major problems. And lastly, I think we've done a better job of communicating with parents. It's not perfect yet. Communication can always be improved, but I'm very happy that we've started asking formally for feedback from parents. I think that's very, very important to improving our system. There's a lot of unfinished business, of course. I don't think there would ever be a time anybody could ever leave the board and say, well, good, that's done, everything's set, and no problem to go off the board. But I think one of the things I would like to see continue is an assumption that change and assessing and improving is just part of the culture here, that by looking at things and asking questions, that's not to assess blame, it's only to make things better, to make programs work better for students, to make operations go more smoothly for staff. I hope, I'm kind of jumping the gun on what you'll be talking about in terms of the goals, but these are things that are very close to my heart that I've been speaking strongly for, I think, over the years. Continuing to hold our teachers to high standards and give them ample opportunities for development, and expecting participation in curriculum development and staff development by all our staff. And to find ways to structure those opportunities so they're not at the expense of the student day. We've simply got to keep working on those issues. Another one is that I think people really need to be sensitive to is working with the town council. We do have a lot of changes in the town council, a lot of people who don't have kids in school, and I think it behooves us to reach out to the town council and to everybody else in town who doesn't have kids in the school, bring them into our school, show them what we're doing. Budget times aren't probably going to get any better, and the more people understand about what we're doing, the better. And lastly, this kind of ties into some of the things we were talking about tonight. Continue to try to take the long view and not make decisions based upon a set of circumstances at the moment. And sometimes that seems harsh, or that you're not meeting the needs of a particular family or a particular situation, but I really do believe that policies are the best, good, thought-out policies are the best protection in terms of gaining the time and energy to move forward with improving curriculum and those kinds of matters. Otherwise, we fall down day to day. This situation tonight in talking about the foreign exchange student just, you know, brings to the fore how hard it is to be on the school board. You want to help people in every situation and make their situation absolutely perfect. As a board member, you can't always do that. That's difficult, and they're not always popular. But I know, for one, as a school board member, I have always tried to get all the facts I possibly could, listen to all sides, and make a decision that is in the best interest over a period of time, even if it was gut-wrenching for me personally, and even if it made people very angry. And looking back, I feel like I've been true to that. And lastly, I just want to thank all the two very able and wonderful superintendents who I've served with, who've just been incredible. I look forward to working with Cynthia some more in my new capacity, and all board members, present and past. It has been a real pleasure. I think one of the hallmarks of this board that you don't see in every other town is the ability to have vigorous discussion and differences of opinion and still respect each other, come back to the table and keep working on those issues and not to hold a grudge. That's incredibly important, and I don't know if people in this town know how great that is, not to have school board members stabbing each other in the back and dealing with petty issues among themselves. It does happen a lot in other towns. And again, to the staff, the administrators, the teachers, I don't want to start naming names because you get caught, but I consider myself lucky to have had good, strong, respectful relationships with everybody in these buildings. So I'm going to miss that day-to-day activity, but I'm only an 800 member. So I look forward to working with you in that new expanded capacity, and thank you for putting up with that rather lengthy speech. I just want you to also know, when I came on the board, I was petrified of speaking in public. Petrified. I never took a college course where I had to give an oral presentation. So thank you also for putting up with my ramblings as I practice my speeches.
Charlie, can I just say very quickly? I just have to say that Anne is the reason I am here. She recruited me after she'd been on the board 1 year and they were desperate for people to run for school board. She's a good friend who I will miss. And Anne, we will not be you ladies anymore. I'm sure I will get blamed for everything that the school board does. But as Keith told me beforehand, he said he didn't think I'd have any problem being the only lady.
I don't think so.
I know. But thank you, Anne, for challenging me to do this. Until you do it, you do not know how difficult.
I'm sad, you know, I'm certainly happy for Anne. As a new board member, I've been involved in many heated battles, and most of the time, Ann and I have been on opposite ends of those battles, but I've never ever doubted the sincerity of her intent to do well, and certainly I'm going to miss her. She couldn't have found a more perfect job than this policy thing, because it is she's just perfect for it, and I know that she'll be very successful, and so we wish her well.
It is with much regret that we accept the resignation of Ann Chapman.
And I'm going to break policy and second that only because Ann and I go back a long way.
We should, yeah.
Any other comments? All those in favor? Okay, before we adjourn, I remember Ann, it's funny, today we approved, reapproved, or reactivated the school space study committee, and that's when I first met Ann. She came forward as a public citizen as part of that committee. She'd also been very involved in the Parents Association, and I could see right from the beginning in that arena of that committee. She was very pro-school. She was not reacting to what was going on at the time, but was really concerned about where we were and where we were going. When the board was expanded that year from 5 to 7, she chose to run for the 1 year interim term. I think not quite sure if she really wanted to take that on as an avocation, but she found it stimulating. We moved on and knew that we had to do something about our facilities. And over the years, as George has said, we've not always agreed on things, but in the end, I think the board as a whole had students and staff as a primary concern, and that was educating our kids. And, you know, I've been through a lot of AM as far as negotiations, and countless hours of the building committee, strong advocate along with that for our furnishings committee for renovating facilities. When you want to, I can remember our discussions and about colors. But we compromised, and that was what was good. That we have a board that does compromise. And that doesn't mean that we forsake our values. So on behalf of the board, I'd like to give you a little token of our esteem.
Oh, 30,000.